Welcome back to the Business Show. Now, for many, agriculture refers to the rearing of animals and growing of crops, which sometimes is defined as very tedious and unpredictable and boring. But agriculture goes beyond that, and this week on How to Make Money, the Business Show visits Itungu Pastures, a demonstration farm in Wakiso. In this three-part series, we start with the business of pastures, which you could venture into in case you don't want to rear animals or even grow crops.
Farmers, today we are here in Itungu Pastures Farm in Wakiso Town. My name is Pison Usinje, and I'm the managing partner of this farm. Today I want to explain more the business sense of our pastures, why farmers should plant pastures, the business sense of it, and we have many types of pastures, as you're going to see. And why every farmer, every youth, man, woman, you should join this business of farming. There are some people outside there who are not interested in cows. They're not interested in goats. They are not interested in animal rearing. But you can start this business because the land is becoming short, but the people are increasing, animals are increasing. Now, you can start by selling seeds of pastures. You can grow Crois Guyana, harvest it, and sell pastures, okay? Selling seeds out of this. That's one business of selling seeds. Another business sense, you can sell the hay. You do hay, you cut the grass, you bale it into bales and sell it. Not necessarily that you have cows, not necessarily that you have goats, but selling the hay. Another way, you can also sell the silage. You get your maize, you can get your super napier, you get your guatemala, cut it, pack it, advertise it, and sell. When actually you're not interested in animals. Another business sense of it, then you can organize workshops, pasture workshops, where people come, see your pastures, educate them, advise them on how to pasture, and you charge a fee. Another way you can benefit only through these pastures, you can also buy a machine and start hiring machines for cutting these pastures. You hire those machines, those people who have got pastures, but they don't have where to get these machines. So you can have a lot of things dealing with pastures, not necessarily that you have animals. Yes, please.
All right, thank you very much for allowing us to. Let's have the first question. Just briefly run us through the different types of pastures that you have here at Itungu.
Definitely, we have many pastures. Many pastures which are grown here in Uganda. Some are not grown here in Uganda. Some the seeds are here in Uganda. Some are imported. But we are going to categorize these pastures into three. We have legumes, the legume grasses, the bean family, that is alfalfa, the centrosema, the celato, the arabrab, that's the bean family. Mm. And they are bean family, the legumes. Then we have legume trees. The legume trees, these are coriandra, sesbania, those are the trees. We have mulberry, we have grisidia, and those are the legume trees. They fix nitrogen in the soils. They can be used as a protein supplement, and they can be used as windbreakers. For those people who are doing bees, they can supply nectar to the bees, and they are also good. Then from there, then we have the pastures that we can get.
I think let me first stay with the legumes.
Yes.
You've talked about, I think we need to have a conversation on the different nutrients that come off particularly the legumes.
Yes.
Yes. Just tell us a bit about
the nutritional content.
The nutritional content of that.
Most of these legumes, as you have seen, all of them, they are above 20% protein content. In other words, they are all above 20. Most of these grasses, they are below 16. Okay, they are below 16. But the legumes, they are alfalfa, it's about 22. The centrosema is about 22. Then the forage trees, the coriandra, about 22. So most of them, the nutritional content, the protein content is above 20 and above.
So who are the customers for the legume?
The customers, especially for the alfalfa, the rabbit, those people who are having rearing rabbits,
yeah.
Those people who are rearing goats,
okay.
Those people who are rearing the cows. But mostly of recent, people who are taking this alfalfa, the rabbit guys, because it's so much, it contains a lot of protein content.
Mm.
It's a lot of content. It dries very fast, it grows very fast, and people like it. It's a perennial, not annual, it's a perennial crop.
Okay.
So people like it.
That's
so much.
Types. We had talked about, I think, two now. Let's go to the other types of...
Yes, we pastures. Have talked about the legumes.
The legumes, yes.
The legume, the bean family,
okay.
Then the trees family, where we saw coriandra, sesbania, and all that. But moreover, the farmers should know that this is supplement, not a basic diet. It's a supplement. You supplement on top of all these grasses. But then from that family, then we're also going to see the pasture grasses, where we're going to find, also we're going to categorize into two, for silage and for making hay. For those people who don't know hay, say simple, make it a dry grass.
Okay.
A dry grass is hay. A preserved grass as a fermentation is called silage. A simple way. Silage, fermented grass. Hay, a dried grass.
So okay. in short, when you say silage, it's like we said, it's more like maize cutting.
Maize, okay. Chopped maize.
Chopped maize?
Chopped super napier. Mixed with molasses.
Okay.
Yes. And you ensile, okay? You remove the oxygen.
Mm.
That is silage.
Okay.
So let not anyone say complicated, no. Silage, it's a what? It's a grass that undergoes the fermentation process.
Okay.
So let us start with silage. Which are those pastures that can make silage? So pastures that can make silage, we can have maize, we can have sorghum, we can have guatemala. Let us see only those three. Those are making silage. Why making silage? Because they contain a lot of water. The farmers outside there should know, any grass that has got a lot of water, it's good for silage. Okay? Let us also go and see the hay. Hay, we're going to, under the hay family, we're going to see the Crois Guyana. We're going to see the Bracharia mulatto. We're going to see the Syncras. Let us only see the three. Why? Why Crois Guyana? Why mulatto? Why the Syncras? Because they contain less water. Easy to dry. Dry very fast and make good hay. Okay? Now, with those three, the legumes, that's the bean family.
Yes.
The tree family.
Okay.
And the hay. Those are your, in simple terms, those are the three categories of pastures you can have at your farm. But moreover, not all these grasses can be planted on your farm.
Yes.
In other words, the farmer, you don't have to plant all these, the chikuyu, the what. No. The reason why we are having all this is a demo farm.
Mm.
If you're coming from in a wetland, they're going to tell you that this is good. The guatemala is good. The giant cetaria is good.
Okay.
If you're coming from a dry area, like Chulhura, Isinjiro, some areas of Kabong, Nakasongora, Crois Guyana, is good to go. If you're coming from central, the Chifuta, the Bracharia mulatto, is good. So don't see all this here that, oh my God, me, I'm finished. I'm going to plant all this. No, plant the pasture. And that's why Itungo Pastures is here for you.
Mm.
We're going to advise what area, what plant, you're going according to your animals, your interest. Like for example, for the goats,
yes.
Hay is good. But for the cows, silage is good. But for the rabbits, alfalfa is good. So what kind of animals, what type of animals do you have? You just come here, visit us, we're going to show you
all right.
What you're doing. Yes.
Okay, so let me then ask from there. People then ask and say, I'm not interested in cows or goats and all that, how much land do I need, particular type of grass, to make some money? And who are the customers? Where do I find the customers?
Yeah. Of course, we have what they call a comparative advantage. The comparative advantage, it is like you should do something where you see the comparative advantage. You're not going to go in Bujiri and start planting hay, because Bujiri guys are into sugar cane. But when you go to Chiruhura, when you go to Mbarara and do hay, and come to Wakiso, you do hay, you're going to get many, many customers. If you're into you're in Guru, you do a silage, very few farmers going to buy silage because it's bulky, it's heavy. Mm. But if you're in Wakiso here, 60% of Wakiso people in central here, they're into zero grazing. So silage is going to do business for you. That is number one. Number two, you've got to advertise. God has given us, you know, the TVs, yes. The Urban TV, you guys, you're here. You advertise, okay? Make your thing known. Make your things known. We have social media, the Facebook, the WhatsApp. That's why so people normally see my Tungo Pastures, social media Tungo Pastures, you know, on YouTube. You advertise. That's why people are here, okay? You advertise with people, and they are going, people are looking for pastures. Right now, we're in a rainy season. People are looking for hay. They can't see it. People are having small land. The land is becoming smaller. So instead of going there and looking, oh my God, what can I do? Just come here. That's why we are here. Itungo, we're going to help you. Go slowly with you. Hands on. You're going to see these pastures. Hands on. And what business? How we're going to help you how to do this business.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So as we come to the end of the discussion on business of pastures, one would ask, so about how much would I need to start with? Do I need to start with three different types of, you know, pastures, or I can start with one and then build on that as I get the customer base?
Wow, I like specialization. You can specialize as I've seen. You can say, me, I have got 1 acre. So 1 acre is not good for you to do silage that you're going to sell, because silage you need in tons and tons. But 1 acre, I would advise that person, 1 acre, if you're an urban, specialize in, say, alfalfa.
Yes.
You're going to make hay. Each bale is 20,000, and you specialize in protein. If you're in a bigger area, like you have 5 acres, 10 acres, I would also advise you to do Christ Guyana, okay? Because you're going to harvest 200 bales per acre, meaning you're going to harvest 1,000 bales. That's a good business to go. But then for these people who are in Nakasongora, people who are in, you've got square miles,
yeah.
I would advise them to go for silage, because you're going to have tons and tons and tons. So the question is, where do you fall?
Yes.
Rabbit, go far, far, far.
Well, surely money can be minted from agriculture as long as one remains innovative. Don't miss part two of this interview next week on The Business Show. Let's now move on to our personal finance, where Augustine Tamale wraps up on the major platforms that could help you reap money. This week, he offers tips for those planning to venture into agroforestry.
Hello, Augustine Tamale, my name's, and today I would like to move to agroforestry. It's another interesting area for our entire package of agri-business. Now, agroforestry is where you are planting the trees for commercial gain. There is this environmental protection where you plant trees to have a good condition within your home, within your farm, but also to contribute towards a good weather for the country. Because again, with the deforestation, we can end up becoming a desert. So there is that approach, and I encourage it as well. Let's plant trees in our homes, in our farms, our gardens, let's plant trees. However, the planting of trees can also be a commercial venture where you will harvest them. It can be a commercial venture. When you get into this commercial planting of trees, you can even receive carbon credit. There are payments that come in because you are cleaning the environment. You need to get in touch with the National Forestry Authority. They compute for you how much you're going to be earning because of your contribution, if you're doing it on a large scale. The trouble in agroforestry is here, because the mathematics is so nice when you see whether you're going for eucalyptus, whether you're going for any other type of tree, teak tree, whichever you go for, the mathematics is so nice when they compute for you. You just realize you're going to make a lot of money. In fact, if you did a square mile, you're going to harvest $1 billion. In fact, did I say billion? Should be $4 billion, because it's like $1 million. It looks so nice, but the risk is so high. The soil must be tested so that you are sure of which type of tree will thrive on that soil. If you just go in, you will plant the trees, they will flourish for even a year or two, then they begin dying. Then your entire investment collapses, because trees involve a lot. Getting the seedlings themselves, if you are doing like 8 acres, getting the seedlings and planting them, then plowing or weeding through, that costs you about 5 million shillings for just 8 to 10 acres. So if you didn't do the soil culture properly, then in 2 years that entire 5 million has evaporated, and even your expectations of earning are gone. Your time is lost. If you had done something else, you would have progressed. So you must understand the soil culture. You need the proper soil scientists to check for you and then advise on the type of tree you are to go for, or no tree at all. Probably your land is for upland rice, it's not for trees. So you need to understand that, and you do it appropriately. The next thing you need to invest in is the manpower to protect your trees. We have people who set up fires and your entire plantation is lost. So you need to have manpower to protect, so that they can identify a fire approaching your farm early on, and then it can be put out. You need to also behave well on the village. Greet the people. Some villagers just need greeting, and that's all. So when you are planting trees, you must be a good citizen on that village. Don't just stay here in town and turn up once in a while. Go and be part of that village, occasionally participating in the communal work. They're going to be your friends. The other bit is you must tour the entire plantation periodically. People can start harvesting. You know, even 2-year-old trees can be sold. You could be waiting for 10 years, and people begin harvesting from a certain portion of your plantation. So you need to regularly tour the entire plantation. They could be harvesting in the middle. Don't just go around it. They might be harvesting in the middle. Go through it entirely. You need to be sure that your trees are all intact. Your minders of the plantation, when they see that you regularly walk through, they will know that this man is careful, and they will not harvest without your permission. So even security and your vigilance are very key in this. Of course, like any agriculture venture, even with agroforestry, the marketing is key. So you need to also talk to the potential buyers and understand how you are going to dispose of these trees when they mature. It will be very helpful. Someone could have told you that, well, these are nice trees for the utility companies, but you don't know whether they are going to take them. They could become crooked. What is the alternative market? So you should have the primary market and the alternative one, such that in case the one you anticipated won't work, then you can switch to the alternative market and be able to succeed. Remember, the fertilization of the land will be key to keep the trees growing. You should understand when to slash and when to stop the slashing, because when they are formed a canopy, then the grass can't grow. But initially you need to slash so that they are not suffocated. The water channels, if it is a flat land, are key to avoid flooding, to drown the trees when they are young. So make sure you do the water channels, the planning of how the drainage will be done. Those are all key aspects, and you can only get to them properly when you have proper consultation. So that's the package of how we can go about with agribusiness and have success in it. The next time we'll move to another active source of income. Thank you for your time.
Now moving on, the shilling remained strong from the Easter holiday. Money markets were fairly liquid according to ABSA as corporates remitted mid-month taxes. Here now is the money market report. Thank you very much for making time. That's it for this week's edition of The Business Show. Feel free to get in touch with me and the rest of the team on my social media handles at Kusasila Viola. You can leave me a comment, a question, and some of the topics you think we should include in this business show. I'll see you next week. Good night.